Tom McGUANE. I'm a rancher and a writer, fisherman, bird hunter.
Well, thank you so much for talking with us, Tom. You grew up in Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
And
Massachusetts.
Right.
Yeah.
And as I understand, as lore has it, had an early interest in writing. Can you remember some of your earliest memories of or influences?
My mother and father were readers. They were both English majors as when they were students. I was a notorious daydreamer.
Yeah.
And I think that reading kind of was ancillary to daydreaming for a long time. And then I also think, because a lot of the stuff that I read, my early influences were quite non-literary. There were books like Kon-Tiki and The Arcturus Adventure and all these things. I think I associated writing with a kind of an adventurous life. And I was always an outdoors kid, you know. And I think, I do know from early on, I was always trying to think of what kind of a life you could have where you didn't have to be indoors. Why that turned out to be writing, I'm not sure, but that's still, you know, the driving conflict of my life is that it's very hard for me to be indoors at any time of the year.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to create these kind of artificial structures, writing in the dark or writing before before anybody gets going in the morning, stuff like that, so that I can catch a horse and saddle it and go someplace or do something, you know, outside. That was the early thing. I didn't want an indoor job, period. But there were always books around the house. My parents had the usual taste for people of their kind. They read The New Yorker and they read John O'Hara all the time. And my father, my family are all from Massachusetts, so they had this. They were really Atlantic Ocean coastal people. So my father was always, he always had Captain Horatio Hornblower books and stuff like that. They were, and my mother was never really resigned to living other than in Massachusetts and near the sea. So when we were kids, as soon as school was out, my mother would load us up and take us back to Massachusetts. So I have a lighter connection in a way to Michigan in a way because I never spent a summer there. I mean, it's always my grandmother's. The Irish all lived in what they call triple deckers, these three-story tenement houses, which were incredibly warm and interesting places for people with verbal interests, because you have your Uncle Frank upstairs and you'd have your Aunt Anna on the first floor. And then everybody eating together and scheming together. And my mother's family were all just such interesting people. They'd grown up poor. My father had grown up poor. My father went to Harvard on an athletic scholarship. My mother went to college. My Uncle Bill sold encyclopedias to get himself through school and put my mother through school. Graduated from Harvard Law School selling encyclopedias. My great Uncle Walter played for the Boston Braves.
Wow.
And these were all immigrant Irish families all living in this tenement house talking about their ambitions. Oh, my Uncle Fred was the first advertising manager of Vanity Fair. These are poor people.
Really?
These are all poor people.
So why did they go to Michigan, your parents?
My father went there just looking for a job.
Uh-huh.
He was he went to get out of college in the bottom of the Depression. My father got out of college with an honors degree from Harvard, and the only job available to him was loading meat in a Cudahy packing truck. Mm-hmm. He was glad to have that.
Do you recall the first story or book or whatever that you wrote?
The very first thing that I wrote? I remember trying to write things. I don't think I completed anything for a long time. And then, I started writing stories in high school, short stories. And attempting to write novels that would go on for 30 pages and collapse. time has a different nature when you're very young, and what it takes time-wise to write a novel is just almost insurmountable. You're 18 years old, you're thinking of sitting down writing 75,000 words, it's just unbelievable.
Yeah.
Yeah. In high school, I had a great friend who was a renowned gay writer, Edmund White.
Mm-hmm.
And he was so smart. I mean, you know, he'd read all of Proust by the ninth grade. And I was a poor student, but Ed thought I was a great writer. And he encouraged me. That was the only encouragement I got. I didn't get it from teachers.
Really?
Yeah. And in fact, I still in touch with him. I heard from him yesterday. Mm-hmm. He's been HIV positive for over 30 years. He's still there.
Still going.
Anyway, he's a great man, a great old friend. But he was really a key thing for me. It's kind of interesting because I was an athlete, you know, kind of a macho kid. Mm-hmm. And he and I were great pals and still are. But his encouragement was critical when I was a kid. I kept a journal and so a little poetry. You wanted to be a writer.
You both went off to college, and
we both. What both?
You and he.
Oh, he went out. I flunked out of college a couple of times. Mm-hmm. Had a .6 average my first year.
It's a good year.
I graduated with honors, and then went on to Yale as a graduate student. Yeah. But I was slow getting going. But one of my problems was, and I suppose it would still be if I had to go back to college, is I was so interested in reading and writing. I was a voracious reader, and I was writing every day. But it was very hard for me to fit, you know, Introduction to Logic, Econ 101. I just couldn't get it in there. And so, you know, I'd be ripping along. I was very intellectually active, very, very busy at my own work, and I was flunking out.
Yeah.
But I've gradually, you know, you get through all that stuff that you're not interested in, you get into your major, and I cruise along, and you get through it.
Yeah. Okay, so your first book, The Sporting Life.
Sporting Club,
I'm sorry. You worked on that, and do you remember the day you actually saw a copy of it with your name on it?
Oh, yeah, surely I do. Mm-hmm. I think I was in Montana by then.
Yeah?
Yeah, I'm not sure I can nail it to the day. I remember it was a great, you know, an unbelievable thing seeing that thing in the mail, you know.
Yeah.
And it was very different, you know. I mean, my books have all been roughly the same size. That book cost $3.95 or $4.95 in hardcover. And if it came out now, it would be $26.95.
Yeah.
And there weren't book tours.
No.
Your book came out. And then about 6 months later, there was a big manila envelope came with all the reviews. With, you know, first class postage, and it plopped in your mailbox. You take it out and see how your book did that year. That was about all you knew.
Hmm. Boy, you didn't run around with it under your arm going, see, I want to show you.
I might have. But, you know, I was trying to figure out how to lever that into some paying work, you know. Mm-hmm. Which was urgently important, and I got some Sports Illustrated assignments, and I can't remember. Sporting Club was made into a movie,
mm-hmm.
Terrible movie, and it was a low-grade bestseller in some countries, with probably Japan being the place that sold the most. Anyway, I got enough out of it to go buy a little place in the Paradise Valley. In those days, I bought a nice little ranch with a beautiful old two-story home with a thing for manufacturing whiskey in the fireplace for illegal Mr. Bootleg thing.
Yeah.
And that was $14,500.
Mm-hmm.
And it had been on the market for 3 years, and when I bought it, I was the laughing stock of the neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, nobody had come here then, you know. I mean, it's very recent, this big passion for Montana. I mean, it hadn't happened yet.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it Montana got very famous very fast, but it didn't, in terms of, if you live here, you know, we lived here and sent four kids to school, mm-hmm. from kindergarten through state university. And that's a different world than the summer population.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, five or 600 PTA meetings really weeds them out.
Good. There you are. You're running a ranch, a family, doing all this, and starting down the road of writing not just novels, but screenplays.
Yeah.
And making a living. How'd you organize your life in those days?
Well, you know, I was really driven by fear to some degree.
Mm-hmm.
And the, you know, one of the unique things about writing for a living is that every time you finish a project, you're out of work again. So I remember it was always this kind of loping pattern. You know, I'd write fiction for as long as I dared, because it was never remunerative. And then I would get on an airplane, go to Los Angeles, and try to get a movie job. I'd come back and write the movie, get paid, and then I'd start writing fiction again. And I would do that until it became foolhardy, and then get on the plane and back to Los Angeles. And I did that, I guess I must have done it for 20 years or something, 15 anyway. And most of them never came to anything, you know, or there were revisions of other people's screenplays. Anyway, it was just shit work is basically what it was. Yeah. There were really not a lot of options. And I was never happy in academe, you know. I didn't think that, you know, I would take the usual route, which is get a job and teaching in an MFA program, which I think they're fine things, but they're for people who were bred to it, and that didn't quite work for me.
Did you develop specific habits about the writing, like a time of day?
Well, I once had the belief that writing was a job like any other job. You get up in the morning, had breakfast, went to work.
Yeah.
Had lunch, went back to work, came home, came in for dinner. But that didn't last forever, partly because you really can't write 8 hours a day, I mean, and have anything happen. I always remember one time I was in that routine, and Russ Chatham, the painter, came by the house, and he said, I just finished lunch. He said, what are you doing this afternoon? And I said, I'm going back to work. And he said, I couldn't live like that. He left. And I remember feeling that there's a kind of a legitimate reproach about that. On the other hand, I mean, I had kids and, you know.
Yeah.
I think I eventually faced the fact that there's no sense in watching your life go by and just sitting there after the day's work has really been finished. And I mean, now, of course this is age-related, but if I get in a 3-hour writing day, I'm doing pretty well anymore. I mean, before it stops.
Yeah.
You know. And so my routine's changed over the long haul. And I would say that when I was really doing that 8-to-5 deal, I was just squandering a part of my life out of guilt or, you know, fear of failure, whatever those things that drive people at that age.
Yeah.
I'd have been miles ahead, you know, doing construction work or something for half a day.
So your method of writing is longhand, computers,
Remingtons? Well, it's been all over the place. I mean, I would say more than half my career was on my Olympia portable, which I bang away on. Computers came along, and those have been a big help for me, because I wrote a novel or two ago. I wrote it longhand, and I have terrible handwriting.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought, at least I can read it. That turned out not to be true.
Oh, no.
I mean, after some of it was 2 years old, I look at it, I could barely figure out what it was. I had to transcribe it all. But word processor's been a bonanza for me. I've never had an assistant of any kind, or a secretary, or anybody to do it, or typist. I haven't had any of those things in a 40-year career. And so to be able to tap things out and correct them and have it all there, I mean, a word processor is kind of a secretary to me.
Right.
And so it was a great leap forward. And it still is. I'll bang things out that way, and then I have to print them. I can't really correct. I can't edit on the screen.
Yeah.
I can't do that.
I don't understand why I can't do that.
I think that's universal. I think... I'm not sure why either. But now, I just did a story for McSweeney's. I don't know if you ever see McSweeney's. Do you ever see McSweeney's? Great quarterly. And they have a wonderful editor, Jordan Bass, and they have this thing called a track log. Do you know what a track log is?
I don't think so.
Well, I just learned it on this one. I've been doing a lot of work for The New Yorker. We haven't done that, but I hope maybe we'll start at some point. Track log, here's your text, blah, 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 all your stuff. And your editor comes in and makes some suggestions. And they, all the suggestions go through there in blue. So you see them all in blue. And then you answer all his blues in, with your replies or your suggested changes. And those all go in red. Everything is dated on the side there. And you have this complete record of everything you're doing, the back and forth. So instead of doing an editorial thing where you and so-and-so agree to cut the third paragraph on page 17, you look back and you think, what was that thing we cut? Or where, what page was it on? Everything is there.
And there it is.
And it's all part of Word Perfect or one of those programs. Yeah. Very, I'm just barely learning how to do it myself, but this editor had it down. It made life really easy.
Oh, neat.
But my relationship now and that sort of thing is very much based on my editor at The New Yorker, who's Deborah Treisman, who's just a great editor. We have this, we're getting to be like, you know, Derek Jeter and, you know, we got the sort of timing on the infield now, so we can really work pretty intuitively.
Mm-hmm.
She's getting a huge award this year. I'm going to go in December, go to New York for it. Ian McEwan is going to be the master of ceremonies, and she's kind of a great editor.
The changes in technology, I mean, from obviously cuneiform writing on clay tablets to computers and so forth, as well as the changes in our culture, do you have any ideas about the future of writing in America, where it might be going, how it's going to change with publishing and writing?
It's changed so much just in my lifetime. And in some way, I've always disliked the idea of the author guru, you know. I mean, they spread the guru status around. They'll ask, you know, as soon as the Beatles have a platinum record, they ask them what we should do about nuclear disarmament, you know.
Right.
And I like the idea, I like the sort of reduced status of writers. I like them being driven back into the human fold. Instead of going around being high priests, you know, the Ezra Pound model or the... some people like Mailer were very upset about that. So literature used to be, you know, primary in the culture. And it's still very important. But it's not about people on their high horse or people making broad statements about how other people should live, despite the way they live. And it's now the world of literature is kind of driven by people who love literature and contribute to it. And it's kind of independent of the economics of things, because right now most of the really good writing in this country is being done by short story writers, and the short story is limping along on very little encouragement. But these wonderful writers keep popping up. A lot of young, really good, there's a new wonderful writer I'm reading now, Claire Vey Watkins, who was, she wrote this, she's being hugely well received. She's the daughter of Charlie Manson's procurer, and she grew up in the shadow of the Manson gang. And she's from Nevada, and she's written this collection of stories about life in Nevada. That's
what,
just
what was her name?
Claire is her first name, middle name Vaye, Vey Watkins. But every year, two or three of these really great young writers kind of turn up. They're usually short story writers. And it's a very different world than the one where we sit around waiting for William Styron or so another one of these bloated figures from, you know, the kind of a boozy, macho, between the wars kind of stuff.
Yeah. Speaking of which, you have no doubt had many times people, young writers or hopeful writers come to you and looking for the imprimatur of your status or the touch to their brow or some advice. Do you have any set advice you give to prospective writers?
Well, yeah, I do. I tell them that writing is a byproduct of reading, and that if they're not avid readers, that I personally, but not exclusively, personally, don't have great hope for their future.
Yeah.
I've known exceptions. I mean, I've known some writers who were quite good who were not particularly well-read or even excited about reading. They're freaks, really. Generally speaking, most writers I know that are literary writers are people who just love books. And one of two things happened. One, they're forced into writing one of their own because they've run out of runway, or they can't quite find the book they're looking for and conclude that maybe they should write it themselves. I think that's part of it.
Hmm.
So when you were young and reading a lot before you started writing, there wasn't anyone in particular that pushed you down the runway?
Oh, gee, let me think. I'm sure there was. Well, there was it was kind of an unusual thing, but there was I went to Harvard Summer School, and it was kind of a non-matriculating student. You didn't really have to be a good enough student to go to Harvard, but you could go there and take the courses. And I took the advanced writing course, which for some odd reason was taught by a Texan, a guy from Nacogdoches, Texas, named Gerald Chapman, who was a renowned 17th century scholar, but he was not a creative writing teacher, but he was passionate about contemporary literature and very, very knowledgeable about modern American literature particularly, and they had him teach that course. And I worked like a madman for him. And I had this moment, I think I've heard myself describing this before, but I went up to the Widener Library to have my personal meeting with him. He was getting ready to go on a camping trip, and he had his Coleman stove out, and he was kind of behind the wings of the Coleman stove trying to figure out how it worked.
In the library?
Yeah. trying to figure out how to work because he was going camping with his wife. So I was waiting there, terrified to hear what he'd have to say about this avalanche of material I put on top of him. And he folded up. He had a real heavy Texas accent, bright red hair. He folded it up like this, put it all, and he said, "Son," he said, "you're a real damn writer." He said, "Are you serious about this?" He said, "'Cause you can be one if you want to." And it just blew me away.
Your feet, did they touch the ground at that moment?
He was by far the biggest influence on me, partly because
affirmation.
He was a fabulous teacher. He'd come to class and he'd say, "I want you all to think about names now. Well, how did Carson McCullers name all the characters in their stories? They're all very distinctive. Do you know the answer to that? I do. And then he'd say, "Well, let's do Faulkner now. Now we'll do Steinbeck. Now we'll do Hemingway. We're going to name names." And, he just blew us out of our chairs day after day. I saw him recently, and he said, "Boy, that was weird. I'd never taught creative writing before." He said, "I was trying pretty hard." He lives in Denver. He started a very important quarterly called the Denver Quarterly, which was a serious 17th and 18th English scholar. I think that's their specialty, but it's an important quarterly. And he taught there for years. I think he's retired. He looks, I don't know what his age is. He must be getting on toward 80. He looks about 40.
Hmm.
And a big football fan. And just, he said, "Well, you know, I've come to Harvard from a long way off." I said, "Yeah, Nacogdoches." He said, "Well, you're damn smarty britches, ain't you?"
Smarty britches.
He was just a hoot. I just loved him. But I came from a kind of a dysfunctional family. There were all sorts of things going wrong in my life. I had everything hanging on my writing life, and I didn't belong at Harvard. I was there with a bunch of really smart kids from Smooth Music and Art in New York and all these kind of super kids, and I was this kid from the Midwest who had recently flunked out of college. And he thought I was by a country mile the best student he'd had.
Hmm.
And that was the first person who ever talked to me like that.
Have you ever told him?
Yeah, I told
how
him.
How important that was?
And, people would tell him that. And he would say, "I don't remember doing that much for him. What's he talking about?" And so I would, like Jim, I was one of the evil companions thing. And they had this big event, and I had to get up and give a little talk about it. And it was a big hall full of people, and he came. And I said, "Mr. Chapman," I said, "I realize this anecdote has been told to you in the past and that you're increasingly irritated by it." And I said, "Whatever it is you do, you did," I said, "I really have to thank you for your timing." And he's a great teacher. It doesn't take but one or a few anyway. You can really, there was another one. There was a guy at Olivet. I just flunked out of college, and I managed to talk my way into this tiny bankrupt college at that time. I think they've done well since then. And they had the dean of the college met with me. It was, I tried to talk my way into school, and I told him I wanted to be a writer. And he said, "Well, who are you reading now?" And I was 18 years old, and I said, "Well, I'm reading Faulkner." And he said, he was kind of a Faulkner scholar, kind of avocationally, and he said, "How many Faulkner novels can you name?" And I named them all. And he said, "Okay, you can come to college."
All right. You win.
It's kind of, I wish it had a happier ending. He went on to be the dean of SMU in Texas. And I was down there for a rodeo. And I called around. There he was in the phone book. And he had retired 20 years earlier or something. So he was living in assisted living. And I called him to assisted living. I told him this whole story. He said, "Do you remember that?" And he said, "No."
Right. So, and then you get a Stegner Fellowship to go to Stanford on the West Coast.
Right. That's the first time I'd been to the West Coast.
Ah. And how did that contrast with the East Coast and Harvard? And
well, you know, I was never really a Harvard guy. You know, I just went out there for that class. So I took, there was a famous guy, I can't think of his name now, who taught American literature, Howard Mumford Jones. And I took Howard Mumford Jones' American literature course, and then I took the advanced creative writing course. It was a phenomenal summer. Just a great summer. But I was so adrenalized by being there at all, you know, this, plus my father had gone there. My father had gone from a poor railroading family. Up, he just lived down the road. He said, "You're going to go to college, just go up the road, go up to Harvard."
Yeah.
And so my grandfather lived in Cambridge. They were so blown away by my father getting into college, they moved there to watch him go to college.
Ah.
Big reason my father went to Michigan, to get away from that. So I was so adrenalized to be there, you know, that I just wrote day and night. And then my grandfather lived there, and I'd go out to dinner with my grandfather. He lived in this little tiny apartment with his Nova Scotia wife. So that was a great year. Stanford was I was so overwhelmed by how beautiful California was, and how beautiful Stanford campus was. This is all, unless you don't want her in the picture.
No, it's fine. It's a beautiful country.
You know, this was before the tech boom and all that. Yeah. This is 1965, I think, or something like that. Well, not much had happened. It was peach orchards all the way to San Jose. And campus was there. It was like this unit out there surrounded by golden hills and oak trees and stuff. So that was the big thing. I had a motorcycle. And,
oh, nice.
Yeah, and I just, I had my old matchless 500cc, and I just rode around those hills and looked at the Pacific Ocean and the little, on the west slope down there, the little Japanese truck farms. And I just was so excited to be there, you know.
Yeah.
I never forget, I think this, every Midwestern kid has this thing where you're driving across America, and then there's this sign that says, "Welcome to California." It just kind of blows your mind. And I easily could have stayed in Northern California, you know. I mean, I know it's changed so much now, but I really liked it, and I had good friends there. I still have some of those friends. I moved up to Bolinas for a year, and then I came here for what was going to be, I had about $600, and I came here and we rented a house in Livingston. I had a one-year-old child, and everybody was so nice to us, you know. We just thought, well, we'll stay here for another couple of months and figure out what to do with our lives. And 45 years came and went. No decision was ever made.
Yeah, yeah. Amazing.
That's how life is, you know. I mean, you don't. You think you're gonna make these executive decisions, and you're just in a kind of rolling wave. And there you go.
Any particular authors that you liked?
Then. Or,
yeah, when you, as you were,
as I was starting out, I loved Sherwood Anderson, I loved Turgenev, I loved Faulkner, I loved Ernest Hemingway's short stories, I loved those little funky little Steinbeck novels, you know, The Wayward Bus and all those kind of off-centered. I've never been able to embrace the big Steinbeck novels particularly, but all those crazy, usually fairly comic novels were great. I was, you know...
Danny and the Boys.
Huh?
Danny and the Boys.
I know, I love that stuff.
Bezonos.
I've read over and over again, read Chekhov stories, I read Dostoevsky, I read everybody. I mean, there was a period in my life when I was reading a book every day of the year. All of them, I mean, Joyce Carey, the English writer, Yves Lemoyne, Flaubert, I had this great passion for Spanish writers, and I could kind of read Spanish. But Cervantes was probably my god, you know.
Yeah.
You do know. Gogol.
Our truck is named the Rocinante truck.
Yeah. Cervantes, Gogol, Machado de Assis, the Brazilian writer. I'm a kind of a promiscuous reader. There are just so many writers I like. I don't have a little canon, you know, that I feel. Most writers, when you ask that question, will have this well-made canon that, and their name is the next one in the box, you know.
Yeah.
Mine's been kind of a mishmash. There are a lot of good young writers that I read now. Some good Montana writers. There's a young woman from Helena, Miley Malloy, who I think's maybe the best young woman writer in the world right now. She won the Aga Khan Prize 2 years ago from the Paris Review, and she writes in the New Yorker. She and I read at the New Yorker Festival together about 4 years ago, I guess. Mm. So she's pretty special.
Well, Tom, this has been perfect, wonderful.
I don't think anybody's going to learn anything from it.
Never intended to teach, only just to inspire, and you've done that. Yeah, if anything else, have convinced a wide swath of people. Fuck the writing, I'm going to go fishing.
Well, I'd like to do that if we got any water left. Gee.
Yeah.
Is there anything you would like to add?
Oh, let me think. The only thing I would say, especially if young writers are looking in, there's something, people keep worrying about the diminished place of literature in this kind of blizzard of, social media television, all the things that are invading that space. But literature does something that nothing else can do, which is to absolutely recreate the specific atmospheres of the times that those writers lived. And as a test, I always recommend this. Look at a movie from 1926 and then read The Sun Also Rises or read The Great Gatsby and ask yourself, which medium really delivered the spirit of that particular age, and on those grounds alone, nothing has ever been able to compete with literature.
Yeah.
I mean, you can I don't know what you can do in other media to figure out what it was like to live at the time of Stendhal or Tolstoy, and yet you read those things and you're there. I mean, it's living to you. Balzac, you know.
Yeah.
Read Perigord or something like that. I mean, you're that, in that moment with them. We're in that psychological environment that existed in such a delicate form that only something that had taken several thousand years to evolve could actually deliver. And so, I mean, I really discourage young people who are writing, especially, or writers of any age, from being daunted by all this talk of, you know, the decline of literature. Yeah, it won't have the same piece of the pie. That's not important. And for cultivated people, it will always be the place to go.
Again, thank you very much, Tom.
My great pleasure. Thanks for being interested.
It has been a kick.